begin with a word of prayer. Dear Father in heaven, we're so thankful for the Sabbath and for the opportunity to study together again, and we invite your presence into this study, into our hearts, into our thoughts. We know, Lord, that the Sabbath is truly a blessing, and we ask for your Holy Spirit to be poured out on the Sabbath. As we're approaching 21 days before December 25th, we know, Lord, that this is a serious time in which we are trying to understand your leading of this movement and your leading of us as individuals, and that all of us are making decisions. And we pray, Lord, that we can walk in the light that shines upon our path. Help us in this study to see things new and old, to understand your word, and to be able to share it with others. Guide and direct this meeting is our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, happy Sabbath, everyone. It's nice to see you here. I always appreciate people who participate. It makes it so much easier to present when I have people to present to. And feel free to comment and ask questions. I know some people have been watching. Some people are here, aren't always here on Friday evening, but you've watched some of the videos online. And in this study, just to sort of bring us to where we're at and what we're doing, this is a study, a weekly study. We probably could have done something like this every day and spent much more time addressing a lot of these details that we're sort of dealing with in passing. But it's a study of the sanctuary message from Eden Lost to Eden Restored. And what we've looked at is these threads that come from Genesis. And these threads are structural threads, but mainly it's about the gospel, and it's about sin and its origins and the sanctuary, which is this remedy for sin. And what we've been looking at over the last little while, dealing with this covenant, and Dwight is addressing it also on Sunday afternoons, is that this covenant that's made with Israel is something that is tied up to the structure of the 2520, which kind of goes to our 2520 study as well in the mornings that we're doing. And the covenant that's made with them is made prior to Moses going up into the mountain to receive the commandments, and that there's this book of the law. And we've done some, I wouldn't use the word speculation, because speculation is, to me, not a great thing. I don't like to speculate. But we've looked at the evidences that this is tied up with the covenant being expressed in Leviticus 25 and 26. That is, Leviticus 25 and 26 express the covenant. And so that the 2520 is tied up with the covenant, and it's tied up with this movement. And this movement is making a covenant. And something about what has been happening to this movement ever since its inception, and especially over our predictions and the structure of the 777 chiasm, all these things are tied together. And so by looking at the past, we can understand the present and see enough into the future for us to walk in that light that's shining on our path. And so that's what we're seeking to do in these studies. Now, last Friday, we looked at Exodus 32, and Exodus 32 is the golden calf. And I can't remember everything that we talked about in there, but anybody remember specifically what was the main highlight of understanding this story of the golden calf? What insight do we have to this golden calf story? What did we bring out?
I don't recall if we brought it out, but one of the points, Moses went onto the top of the mountain after he had been sanctified to be before God.
Okay.
The only other one that was close to where Moses was at that time was Joshua.
Right. Joshua was with him. Yeah.
Aaron was left in charge and was supposed to, in a way, shepherd the people during Moses' absence. Mm-hmm. Now, we're only talking that Moses is out of their sight for a period of 46 days, right?
Well, yeah, 47 days, I think, because there's a week that he's there before the 40 days begin. So I take it as 47 days, but.
Okay. Well.
But maybe, you know, maybe there's 46 if we counted them cardinally or something instead of ordinally. But.
So here is Aaron. And he is wanting the approval of the people.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if we were to look at this portion symbolically, here is Aaron representing some of the leadership of the Seventh-day Adventist Church.
Right. And that was the main thing, I think, that we picked out of this, is that it's something that represents Adventism.
So Aaron gave in especially to the mixed multitude.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was the mixed multitude, those that had chosen to marry Egyptians, that were the greatest of the complainers.
Okay.
So Aaron chooses a path that is saying that he wanted to honor the people over God.
Yeah. Okay. So we can see the parallel between the Adventist church. So we know that the church has broken the covenant.
Right.
Right. So we would say that this is clear in Adventist history, that it's broken the covenant, but it's still God's people, right? So the church isn't Babylon. It's still God's people, but they've broken this covenant. And then there's going to be a remedy that's going to be given. And there was a bunch of things that we were looking at in regard to the gospel itself. So one is, we look at Moses's actions, and he's not involved in self-interest. That is, he's willing to give up eternal life if God would save this people. If instead of blotting them out of the book of life, he says, blot me out of the book, right? So there's something here about this story that we can see as a parallel to Christ, but it also represents something about this movement. That is something about what God has brought this movement through parallels this history, but it also prefigures what's going to happen in the future on the big line. Because this movement, one of the things we've come to understand in our studies is that this movement is about the Sunday law. And then that, you know, 9/11 itself doesn't exist as a waymark on the big line. That 9/11 is part of the Sunday law. It exists within the waymark of the Sunday law on the big line. This is something we came to understand. Not everybody, you know, if you haven't followed this, it might sound strange, but also you can see the sensibleness of it, how much sense it makes. Not that I make sense, but it does, in that this movement, what happened before, so this goes to our morning studies, prior to 9/11, Jeff was looking for the Sunday law, and he would have attached Revelation chapter 18 to the Sunday law. He would not have attached it to some event that precedes the Sunday law. But after 9/11, it took them a few years to recognize that 9/11 was the angel of Revelation 18 coming down, which would have been before the Sunday law. That would have been before how he would have understood it, is that it would be the Sunday law. But now we don't look at 9/11 as the Sunday law on the big line. We look at 9/11 as the first day of the first month, and the Sunday law is the 10th day of the seventh month, right, when we go to Millerite history. But we can see that the first day of the first month to the 10th day of the seventh month is part of a unit, 187 days from the first day of the first month to the 10th day of the seventh month, and it is our line. In 2016, the line that we were given was the first day of the first month, which was April 19th, the fifth day of the fourth month, which was midway, which was the center of the chiasm, which was Boston, July 21st, and then the first day of the fifth month, the midnight cry, August 15th, and then the 10th day of the seventh month, October 22nd, 1844. And we would line up the first day of the first month with 9/11 and the 10th day of the seventh month with the Sunday law, placing midnight and midnight cry as waymarks prior to the Sunday law. And midnight and the midnight cry were waymarks that marked specifically events as we came to understand it back in 2016. We didn't fully understand. We knew it was a repeat of Millerite history, but we came to understand that these were waymarks that preceded the Sunday law and had to do with a message to the Levites, to Seventh-day Adventists. So this whole movement has been about preparing people for the Sunday law. So when we look at this story of the golden calf, where would we place this in our history? Where would we place this within Adventism? Where is the golden calf? Is this the Sunday law? Or is it something else?
It is the Sunday law.
Okay, you say it's the Sunday law? Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Dwight, you had a comment too?
There are some that would say that it's the Sunday law. I'm having to wonder if this is not a return to the Protestant ideals, placing man's word above that of God's.
Okay. Now, one of the things we looked at when we were doing our study on the 2520, we had another history, and that is the history of 2 Chronicles chapter 29 and 30. And in 2 Chronicles chapter 9 and 30, there's this invitation made to Samaria, to Ephraim, to northern Israel. And this invitation is to come participate in a Passover that's going to occur in the second month, because they cleanse the temple in the first month, beginning on the first day of the first month and ending on the 16th day of the first month. And so that covers the period of when you could have the Passover. So they're going to have a Passover in the second month, and they make this invitation. And one of the things I noted, or we noted, is that this occurs just 2 years prior to Hoshea's captivity, to the beginning of the siege, right? So you're going to have the siege of Samaria, and Hoshea, who's the king of Israel, he's going to be taken captive. And that's going to begin the 2520 for northern Israel. And we know that northern Israel is the false prophet. It symbolizes the United States in 1798, 2520 years later, when it rises on the scene. And I'm trying to give this information in the most simple way that I can. But the idea that I'm trying to present here is that we have something at the beginning that parallels something at the end. Now, when it comes to the story of Moses, Moses also has a parallel at the beginning. So we could go to the story of Joseph, and we know that the Joseph typifies Christ, as does Moses. Both of them are typifications of Christ. Now, when we have this history here, we have this history of Moses, we can parallel it to Christ. And so the line of Moses is a confusing one, because we've had a line of Moses dealing with the Exodus. But where do we place Moses in the line? So I'm bringing in too many ideas maybe, but I'll try to bring it together. So when we look at the line of Moses, if anybody remembers the line of Moses, we have a time of the end. Time of the end occurs in the fourth generation. And the fourth generation begins with Aaron. 3 years later, Moses is born. And that's going to be the time of the end. And then where do we put the Sunday law in the line of Moses?
I would have thought it possible at Baal Peor.
Okay. Well, I think we would put it more in connection with the Exodus itself. Wouldn't we put the death of the firstborn as the Sunday law?
You could.
Right. I mean, I'm just saying, where did we always place it? So that's where we've always placed it, in my understanding of it.
Okay.
So when we look at this history that happens after the Exodus, we have that the Passover lamb, right? The Passover. And then we're going to have, you know, the crossing of the Red Sea. And then we're going to have this period of 40 years. This is going to be the first generation. And you're going to have in this first generation, what happens in the first generation?
Can you restate the question?
What happens in the first generation after a reform line?
After any line, you go back into darkness.
Don't you? Well, you have a falling away.
Okay, that's what I meant to say. Actually,
do you have a falling away or an apostasy?
Well, to me, it's the same thing.
I think it's the same, which is described differently.
You know, so
maybe.
So you have a falling away. That is, the first generation loses its first love. There's different symbols that are used in different lines. But when you look at, for instance, here, I'm going to bring this up here. So I'm going to go to this. So I'm looking here at these patterns. So we have Manasseh, Jehoiakim, Jehoiachin, Zedekiah. This is the 25-21, a progressive destruction of four. And then you have a reform line. So Cyrus, Darius, and Artaxerxes. And then you're going to have a failed reform. That's the way that I generally looked at it. That is, you're going to have a reform, but this reform fails. So you have a reform line, a three-step testing prophetic message, but then you're going to have the first generation. And in the first generation, after that reform line has been completed, there's going to be a failed reform. And we're going to see this in, the reform line of Christ, with the cross being, you know, marked with the third, and then you're going to have the fourth generation. I don't want to go into too much detail about these different charts here, but you're going to see, if we go to the line of Moses, you're going to have the progressive destruction of four, Levi, Kohath, Amram, and Aaron marks the fourth generation. 3 years later, Moses is born, and then you're going to have the plagues, and the plague, the 10th plague, is the Sunday law. That's what lines up with the Sunday law. And then you're going to have that first generation. You're going to have the manna, and then finally you get to the golden calf. This is just the way I drew it out back in 2016, and presented this at Lambert Church in an afternoon study that Jeff had me present on this. Now, I'm not sure that I fully understand all of these points, other than we can see the second one is the giving of the law there with the line of Moses. What we have then is we can't look at the golden calf as the Sunday law, because it doesn't fit into the Sunday law. That is, it's something that fits into the falling away of the first generation. So if I was going to compare the golden calf to something, I would compare it to the 1863 chart. Would that not make sense in the context of what I just presented, even though it's a little bit scattered?
That can make sense.
Okay. So when we look at that rebellion that happens with the golden calf, it's in the first generation. That's my point. This is part of that rebellion that occurs in relationship to that first generation that's going to die in the wilderness. Now, there's lots of rebellions that occur along the way. And I'm not saying that we could take each of the events, and maybe we could, and we could somehow match them up with Millerite history. But I would look at the golden calf as being connected to the, and the point is, remember, when we have a reform line, what is the darkness? How is it related to the reform line itself? What does the reform line do in relationship to the darkness?
Makes sense of the darkness? It reforms it?
Well, it addresses the darkness, right? So the light, the increase of light that comes with the reform line is in response to the particular darkness that exists under that progressive destruction of four. And in the history of this line here at the bottom, Levi, Kohath, Amram, and Aaron, what is the darkness that they go into? What would we call it? Two words. What kind of darkness? It's one word, I guess. This darkness. What would that darkness be that they were in?
Utter darkness?
Where were they? Where did they come out of? So it's Egyptian darkness. Right?
Idolatry.
Yeah. So this Egyptian darkness that they're in is this slavery to false worship. No. That just didn't make sense. So a reform line addresses that. Does the golden calf as a rebellion, does it represent a rejection of the reform line or some aspect of the reform line?
Absolutely.
So that's the way that I look at it in my understanding of this, that there's a period of darkness, the reform line addresses that darkness, that reform line establishes some things, but in the first generation, some aspect of what has been established as truth is going to be rejected. And in Millerite history, it's going to be the 2520 that's rejected, not the 2300 days, and not the 70 weeks. 1335, I guess, also is somewhat rejected, though that takes longer to happen. But in the first generation, they're going to reject the 2520. Whether they openly reject it or if it's just a neglect of it, they definitely had an opportunity to understand the 2520 when Hiram Etson wrote his seven articles in 1856. But they didn't follow on. And so we're going to call that, and we call the 1863 chart the image of jealousy. It's you know, we can compare it to Ezekiel. So just because something has certain aspects and we can look at them and we can say that they have certain details that we could try to attach to the Sunday law, that, and they do represent it, but they, when you put them into a line, they have a particular place. And so the golden calf is not the 10th plague. It's not the Sunday law. Now, there's different ways in which people have taken the line of Moses and written it out. So I don't have a good understanding of why they made some of the different arguments, even though we tried to find that out. They never had a solid explanation of these lines. They created them, but they never continued to address them. And it's still something that I want to do, is go back and show that this is a prophetic chain, that we can take these 3-1 combinations, which is represented by the three angels' message, and then the fourth. And the fourth is a failed reform line. Now, in our history, what we had done is we had taken the three angels' message and we just put the fourth as the Sunday law, right?
Yeah, I've seen that before.
Because that's Ellen White's line. She's going to do that. She's going to have the three angels' message. When the other angel comes of Revelation 18, that's going to be the Sunday law. But Jeff had understood that when you have the fourth come, it's the second. And that means, and when you, since you can't have a third without a first and a second, that means you also can't have a second without a first. So that means there's a repeating of the first angel's message in order to get the second angel's message. Now, Jeff's movement at the beginning was presenting the first angel's message. But after 9/11 marks the arrival of the second angel's message. So Jeff's movement, what God was unfolding to Jeff prior to 9/11, was the first angel's message. And then Jeff has a part in the second angel's message. But even in this history, in this repeat of history, it's all of it is just the Sunday law. But we're not doing what Jeff did, at least I don't, when I do this chart here, because when I go to Millerite history, I'm going to take the progressive destruction of four. The 1260 is the fourth. That's the period of darkness. Then the first is going to be 1798. The first angel arrives. The second angel arrives April 19th. The third angel arrives October 22nd. And Ellen White sees the Sunday law way in the future. But in the first generation, you have something that's going to typify the Sunday law. But that's in a rejection of the message. And so 1863, to me,
the Blair Bill?
Well, you're talking about 1888. So that's the Sunday law. But this history, I'm saying it all goes together. That is, what happens 1863 right. is that second angel's message. That's the rebuilding of Jericho. That's the image of jealousy. So it is, this, in a sense, the Sunday law. All of this is the Sunday law. But this is the Sunday law as it failed to work in Adventism. That is, Adventism is now rejecting the first, second, and third angels' messages. In 1851, I put here, you know, they lose their first love, right? They become Laodicean, however you want to look at it. There's lots of different ways you can look at their rejection of the first angel's message, the fear of God and give glory to him, you know, for the hour of his judgment has come. They definitely are not fearing God anymore. And then in 1863, when they organize as a church, they organize as a church because they are not accomplishing what God wanted them to accomplish. Christ should have come back in this history if the line had followed what it should have, that is, what God's purpose was. But we also know that ifs are big things, that this represents what happened in every history. But now we're in the fourth generation, which began in 1957, and we're in another reform line, which is paralleled by Millerite history. So in understanding then this falling away, that this marks something in Adventist history that happens in the first generation, at the beginning, right after we are given the message. Right? This movement comes to understand the truth, the Sabbath, the sanctuary, all the truths that we have on the 1850 chart, but then we're going to reject them. And is the 1850 chart the law? So think this through here. The 1843 and the 1850 chart, do they represent the Ten Commandments, the two tables?
Yes.
Okay. So then we're going to have 1863. Yes. Yeah. So in 1863, they're going to produce a new chart. Now, when they produce that new chart, what else do they produce?
Falling away of old truths?
Well, they're going to present two charts, correct, in 1863?
Well, they produced quite a few charts.
Well, no, but they produced two different charts. The Law of God chart and the Prophecies of Daniel and Revelation chart. And also, they write something in a book, The Key to the Prophetic Chart.
There's some sketches, sketchbook.
The which?
Sketches.
Sketches?
Forget the name of it.
Well, they have a book called The Key to the Prophetic Chart. That's the book that's produced in 1863. So they make two charts and a book. Now, when the law is given on Mount Sinai, they go into covenant, right? All that the Lord has said, we will do and be obedient. Even prior to the law being spoken, they say this. After the law is spoken, they again, and as Dwight has pointed out, there's this book that is not the Ten Commandments. And blood's going to be sprinkled on this book. So this book, trying to understand that's one of the things we're looking at on our Sunday afternoon studies. So I'm not going to go into the detail there. But then they're going to receive the law the second time. Mm-hmm. And when they receive the law the second time, it's going to have two new tables and a book. Correct? The first two tables are going to be broken.
Correct.
And that's what we're going to be looking at today. And I want us to see that there is a parallel to this history of what should have happened. So this is a failed reform line that happens in this history. We are now fulfilling the role that should have been fulfilled in early Millerite history. That's what this movement is doing. Can people agree that what we're doing is we're repairing the breach, we're going back and to the old paths, and that one of the things that was restored in this movement was the 2520 that was rejected in 1863, and that is connected to 9/11, which is this light of the second angel. I don't know if I'm saying it well, but does that make sense to people? I want to make sure that people understand what I'm talking about.
Yeah, it makes sense, yeah.
Okay. Now, it makes sense to you. How about other people?
Yeah, it makes sense to me too, yeah.
Okay. So when we go back to Exodus now, and I can't study every single verse. You know, I wish I could. I wish we had the time to go verse by verse through the entire Bible to establish these things in connection with the sanctuary. But what we're going to have is we're going to have this golden calf, this rebellion, and we're going to have a representation of Christ where Moses is standing in the same place as Christ. Christ was willing to have his name blotted out of the book. He was willing to die eternally if he could save one of us. Now, so Exodus 33, I'm not going to leave it look at this too much. There's a bunch here, only that they're going to leave Mount Sinai. This is say, go, the Lord said unto Moses, depart and go up hence, thou and the people which thou hast brought up out of the land of Egypt, unto the land that I swear unto Abraham, to Isaac, Jacob. I will send an angel before thee. I'll drive thee out the Canaanite, the Amorite, the Hittite, the Perizzite, the Hivite, the Jebusite, unto a land flowing with milk and honey. For I will not go up in the midst of thee, for thou art a stiff-necked people, lest I consume thee in the way. And so there's going to, and they still have ornaments that they have. No man did put on his ornaments, so it's kind of weird, but I guess they didn't give all of it for the golden calf. And then there's going to be this tent of meeting. Moses took the tabernacle, pitched it without the camp, far off from the camp, and called it the tabernacle of the congregation. It came to pass that everyone which sought the Lord went out unto the tabernacle of the congregation, which was without the camp. And it came to pass when Moses stood out unto the tabernacle that all the people rose up and stood every man at his tent door and looked after Moses until he was gone into the tabernacle. And so God's going to speak with Moses. And he turned again into the camp, but his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, departed not out of the tabernacle. So there's a whole bunch here I'm just going to skip. And Moses is going to make this intercession, right? And in this intercession, he wants to see God's glory. So he says in verse 19, or verse 18, Moses says, and he said, I beseech thee, show me thy glory. So what is Moses asking for when he's asking to see God's glory? Why is he asking this? So first, God is asking him to lead the people, right? So Moses is going to have to lead them into, you know, to the promised land. That's what's being said. And Moses asks to see God's glory. Why is he doing this?
His glory is his character.
He wants to know him.
But why?
So that he can lead the people in the character of God.
Okay. Yeah. So we know he wants to be transformed himself. But the question is, why is he particularly asking this? Think about a reform line. Don't think about Moses himself personally. Think about how this fits into a reform line. Because Moses is in here typifying something. And what is he typifying?
The angel that comes down.
Okay, so the angel that comes down. So, and I think that's a good point. So he's looking for something that we're looking for. Something that we need to see. Now we see it in the lines. So we're not going to necessarily see an angel come down in literally. But when we talk about glory, we're talking about God's character. Now think back to July 18th. So July 18th, what was it we were expecting to see?
An event to happen.
Okay, we're expecting to see an event. What?
An external event to happen.
Okay, and it was... We wanted to see it. Why? What was our reasons that we needed to see it?
Well, we did it to warn him, for his warning.
Okay, was that for our glory or for God's glory? July 18th.
Strictly for God's glory.
Okay, it was, well, it was supposed to be, but what were people looking at it for? Weren't we talking about our vindication?
Correct.
Okay, that's the way that it was understood. We're going to be lifted up as an ensign. And what that meant to people was some kind of vindication, that all of these people that I've witnessed to, that have mocked me, that have laughed at me, that said I was in error, now they're going to see that I was right. Isn't that what we isn't, especially after July 18th, wasn't this the complaint?
That's what we were saying, yes.
Yeah. So we're saying, now I look like a fool, and I'm not going to have any influence with anybody. And it was really about our own hurt feelings that we would make those kinds of claims. But the problem was, our purpose in seeing July 18th fulfilled wasn't for God's glory.
Especially for our glory.
Yeah. So.
And we wanted to warn him also.
Yeah.
Hard to warn him, but yeah. Well, yeah. Part of it was for our glory too.
But yeah, but I think what I saw, and even in my own heart, I'm not talking just about other people, but when I examined my own heart, I could see that the only reason I would want it to occur is so that I would be vindicated. I recognize that this is not how God operates. The reason why I believe that July 18th possibly wasn't going to happen was because I didn't feel that I myself was personally ready for it to happen. And so when it comes to showing up, when Moses is asking to see God's glory, remember what he said in chapter 32, you know, blot my name out of the book of life. Moses is recognizing something that this movement has to recognize. And we've talked about it. We talk about the Marae vision, right? A revelation of Jesus Christ. But mostly what I've seen in this movement, when it came to organization or what was going to happen when we're lifted up as an ensign or we're going to have the church triumphant, is people were looking at this much in the same way as those that made the golden calf. That is, we were being called to make a covenant, and that covenant was about us. It wasn't about God. All that the Lord has said, we will do and be obedient. Is there something wrong with that? All that the Lord has said, we will do and be obedient. When they made that covenant with God, is there something wrong with what they said?
No.
Not wrong with what they said. It's what they didn't know their own hearts.
Okay, so
like Peter didn't know his own heart either when he said, "Jesus, I'll die for you."
So it was based upon their promises, right? That's what we've seen in the study in the book of Hebrews, that the new covenant is based upon better promises. It's based upon God swearing by himself, by two immutable things, because God swears by himself and he can't lie. Now, Moses understands this. He has gone through some experiences, and he doesn't mean that he's going to be perfect, because he's in the end going to, you know, strike the rock instead of speaking to it. But here at this point, he's representing a certain, as a prophet, he's representing a waymark. He's representing something that this movement is about, and that is, we need to see God's glory. This is not about us making a promise to God. It's not about us overcoming sin in and of itself, even though it's important. We would all agree that we're not, you know, sin is destructive. But this is something about what God is doing, and his glory, his character will be seen upon us, not because of our works, because of our righteousness, because all of our righteousness is filthy rags.
Right.
He's going to remove that filthy rags from us, and he's going to clothe us with a change of raiment. And who does he do that with in the book of Zechariah. Who receives this change of raiment?
Joshua the high priest.
Joshua the high priest. Does Joshua the high priest represent this movement?
Yes.
Yeah. He also represents Christ, but he represents this movement. Now, Christ had a fallen human nature, but Christ never sinned. He didn't have a filthy garment to have removed. So that vision of Joshua the high priest symbolizes the work of Christ completed in his people. And that name of Christ, Joshua, that's just the name Jesus, is going to be seen upon his people. That is, the same character that was seen in Christ will be seen upon his people. This is what this movement is all about. Preparing for the Sunday law is not about knowing, you know, when the Sunday law is going to happen, or knowing about the Sabbath, or knowing about different end time events, you know, knowing about the state of the dead or different things like that. It's about glorifying God's character in our life, in our words, in our actions. And this reform line is demonstrating that that has to happen prior to the Sunday law, that this work has to be done in our lives, because this group, whatever it is, I don't understand it, because we look at ourselves, we know we're just a ragtag bunch of people. We're not particularly talented. We're not particularly gifted. All that we have is in Christ. We don't have anything really to offer except to have God take over our lives. And that's what we're asking him to do. And that's why we're studying. And when we're studying, are we asking God to show us his glory?
Yes. I would say yes.
Yeah. So God says to him, I will make all my goodness pass before thee, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee, and I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. And he said, thou canst not see my face, for there shall no man see me and live. And the Lord said, behold, there is a place by me, and thou shalt stand upon a rock. And it shall come to pass, while my glory passeth by, that I will put thee in a clift of the rock, and will cover thee with my hand while I pass by. And I will take away mine hand, and thou shalt see my back parts, but my face shall not be seen. Now, this is a very strange request that Moses has, and a very strange explanation of what Moses is going to see. I've always been fascinated by this ever since I've read it. Now, I believe there's a lot of symbolism here that, you know, we don't really have time to go through. And there are also some practical things. What does it mean, you cannot see my face? We say that Moses talked to God face to face. So what is happening here? Why can he not see his face?
I was thinking in that Moses speak with God face to face.
Yeah, so he talks to God face to face. That's the expression.
Hi, guys.
But here, hi, Mark. So here, Moses is not going to see God's face. Yeah.
Video, please.
Yeah.
I'm very sorry. I say, excuse me, please.
Yeah.
For being rude. I asking of you and other people online of explained why the sun and moon and stars to bow down to me.
Well, I don't know if the sun and the moon and the stars can bow down to you.
Yeah.
You're outside.
There's I think my aid is very, very weird. Very weird. I don't know why sun, moon, and stars bow down to me. I don't know what they be explain that. calling this bell study. I bet that.
Okay. Well, I don't. Okay, Mark, I don't think I can answer this question.
Yes, but one small thing.
Yeah.
Linda and I not ever seen no moon. We don't know where is the moon is.
Where the moon is right now?
Yes.
Well, right now, it's the moon is going, it's going to be rising. Right now is the time of the new moon. So you're basically at the time of the conjunction. So there is no new moon. But in about 3 days, you'll see the first visible crescent. So right now, the moon is on the same side of the Earth as the sun is. So the moon's in the sky during the day. And so you can't see it because the sun lights up the sky. Does that make sense? Mark?
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay. Anyway, we're going to go on with our study. Okay? Okay.
Sure, sure.
Thanks, Mark. I appreciate it. Now, so this idea of the face of God, that you no man can see me and live, God dwells in unapproachable light. Now, isn't this the Son who's going to be showing himself to Moses, or is this the Father? What does this mean? Who is he asking to show his glory? Because as far as I understand, it would be Christ in this case. So what does he mean, you cannot see my face, for there shall no man see me and live? Because he's been talking with him face to face. And we know that Christ has appeared to Abraham, right? So what is being said here?
Not be seeing the Father's face. Well, can't see the Father's face as opposed to...
And that's the thing is, I mean, he's showing him something that I don't think I understand. I mean, I don't know everything that's being said here. I don't think that we could see the Father at all because he dwells in unapproachable light. But I'm just saying that there's something about when he shows his face in this context that he's showing him something that he can't see and also live. So there is something here that I don't understand, but I think we'd have to try to understand what he means, you cannot see my face.
I know God the Father hid his face from Christ.
Yeah.
On the cross. So I'm wondering if this correlates with that somehow.
Okay. Okay. But yeah, so there's a hiding of a face here, but that's going to be different, but maybe there is some parallel there. Okay, now the clift of the rock, so he's going to be put in a crack, right? So he's going to be hidden there. The glory is going to pass by. God's going to proclaim his glory, and he's going to cover him with his hand, and then he's going to remove his hand, and you can just see his back parts, but my face shall not be seen. So there's something here. I don't have the answer to it. I wish I did. I'm asking a question, and I don't know if we have the answer to it completely. The only thing I can say is that this is something that's parallel in this movement right now. Yep. Yeah, William.
Wouldn't he be in the sanctuary? Wouldn't he be in front of the ark, in front of the sanctuary, where he'd be showing his backside? He'd be facing the ark.
Well, right now, you mean in heaven at that time, in the time of Moses, or now?
We're at the time of, you could say at that time, yeah. He was showing him the sanctuary, right?
Yes, but he's not ministering in the sanctuary. I mean, because the time, you know, he at first has to offer himself as a sacrifice in order to do that. So okay. I don't know how the question really makes sense in that right now.
I mean, if he was looking at it at his backside, that's what I was thinking. If he could only see his backside.
Okay, I see what you're saying. So as a symbol, this shows us looking at Christ while he's ministering in the sanctuary, in some kind of symbol for us now. But we need to see God's glory, right? This is essential for each of us to see God's glory. Because one is, we don't realize who we are. That is, we're not honest with ourselves about our spiritual condition. We think we're much better than we really are. So we need to see God's glory. But we can't see his face, because if we saw his face, we wouldn't be able to live, at least in this context. But I do think that we have to see God's face at the end of the world in order to see God's face. That is, if we have not had an experience that's deeper than Moses's experience, we won't be able to stand in the time of Jacob's trouble, in the sight of a holy God without a mediator. So this history parallels ours, but it's different, right? Because it's a parallel, but there are details that are different with this history than with ours. And we know that this movement right now is repeating all of these histories in order to accomplish a work. Now, the part I wanted to focus on, so we have Moses, he broke the Ten Commandments when they rebelled and they had this golden calf. He offers himself in the place of these people, that he would have his name blotted out of the book of life. He stands as a mediator, as Christ. And then he's going to be told by God that he's going to lead this people. And then he says to God, show me your glory. Now, he's going to receive the Ten Commandments again. That is, he receives them a second time. And this is parallel, I believe, in the failed reform line of Millerite history with the two tables, the 43 and the 50 chart representing the Ten Commandments. And then they're replaced by the Law of God chart and the 25-20 chart, which has now been, had the 25-20 removed, though it's hidden in the top right corner in the Week of Christ. So we'd call it, I guess, the 1863 chart is just the visions are not written on the table. That is, it doesn't speak, but they're going to be written in a book. And Joseph Bates, he applies this to a prophecy from Isaiah that says, write it in a table, noted in a book, for it shall be for a rebellious house. And so he applies the 1863 chart prophetically, not as a fulfillment of Habakkuk 2, but a fulfillment of Isaiah. I can't remember which chapter it is. Somebody could look that up if we wanted. You just type in table and book, and you'll find the verse. So I know I'm trying to bring some of these ideas together. Yep, Mark.
Please.
Okay.
I will be in right back of a parents make kids pop in the house.
Okay.
I am not ready to sit down on my brown chair. And I in Wilbur's study 10 minutes now.
Okay, Mark.
I'm not ready to be fall okay. In relax 5
okay, Mark,
minutes.
You don't have to tell us.
Wilbur's study.
Okay, Mark.
I will tell you, I will come back.
Okay, take care, Mark. Okay, so in Exodus 34, Moses is going to receive these tables. And remember, the first time, the tables are prepared by God and written with his finger. The second time, Moses prepares these tables. The Lord said unto Moses, hew thee two tables of stone like unto the first, and I will write upon these tables the words that were in the first tables, which thou breakest. And be ready in the morning, and come up in the morning unto Mount Sinai, and present thyself there to me in the top of the mount. And no man shall come up with thee, neither let any man be seen throughout all the mount, neither let the flocks nor herds feed before that mount. And he hewed two tables of stone like unto the first, and Moses rose up early in the morning, and went up unto Mount Sinai, as the Lord had commanded him, and took in his hand the two tables of stone. And the Lord descended in the cloud, and stood with him there, and proclaimed the name of the Lord. And the Lord passed by before him and proclaimed, the Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering, and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children and upon the children's children unto the third and fourth generation. And Moses made haste and bowed his head toward the earth and worshipped. And he said, if now I have found grace in thy sight, O Lord, let my Lord, I pray thee, go among us, for it is a stiff-necked people, and pardon our iniquity and our sin, and take us for thine inheritance. So how would we apply this to us at the present time? I mean, we're looking at some things, the giving again of the law, the proclamation of the character of God by God himself, and the revealing of God. So who does Moses represent in this instance?
The priests, I think.
Okay, well, he represents the priests. I mean, he would represent this movement in some way. He definitely doesn't represent some individual.
No.
He represents humanity, don't he? When he's at the stones, he represents humanity joining with divinity, right?
Yes, but this is, yeah, so he's humanity and divinity are combined. So this time he prepares the stones rather than God preparing the stones, and God's going to write them still. So God is going to write his law upon our hearts. Right? There's a lot here dealing with this, the writing of the law the second time. Now also when we look at this, where have we seen this before? And somebody's microphone's on, so I'm getting a lot of noise. I don't know who it is. There's a couple of people with microphones on. So I guess that was Jeff making the noise. So where have we seen these words before? Keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity, you know, not exactly word for word, but especially visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children, and upon the children's children unto the third and fourth generation.
Those are the Ten Commandments.
Yeah, that's in the Ten Commandments itself, right? So why is God saying this? And what particular commandment is this?
Second.
Yeah, so if you go here, this is in talking about idolatry by making graven images. So thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or any likeness of anything. So this would be how are we taking these commandments here? Thou shalt have no other gods before me, thou shalt not bow down to thee and to make a graven image. We went through these commandments. The third one is thou shalt not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain, right? So this is the second commandment. And why is it the second commandment? Have we thought about these? I don't think we went through this when we went through the first four commandments. And we know the first four commandments deal with our love towards God. But what are the first four commandments doing if we take them all together as a unit? We know the Sabbath is
a service to God.
Okay, so what is this? What are these Ten Commandments? What is happening here in these Ten Commandments? What is God doing?
He's revealing his character.
Okay, he's revealing his character. He's revealing who he is, right? So first, we know he says, "You shall have no other gods before me, or you will have no other gods before me. I'm the Lord thy God that brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Thou shalt have no other gods before me." So he first starts off who he is. I am the Lord thy God. And because of he's brought us out, we're not supposed to have other gods. So this is, what is he doing there when he makes that statement?
Brother, if you obey the first four commandments, is your relation with God. You love God.
Okay, yeah, so they have to do with our love towards God. But what is God doing when he's making these first four commandments, when he's stating them? What is he doing? Because remember, chapter 19, Dwight, yeah, so...
Okay, what he's doing is he's pointing back to the covenant, but I mean, I'm looking at this in a way I've never really considered before.
Okay.
Could we parallel these first four commandments with Revelation 14 and the other angel of Revelation
14? Yeah. Okay, so yeah, we can compare them with the three angels' message and the fourth. Okay. I would say that's true. And so in context of chapter 19, when they first make the covenant, all that the Lord has said, we will do, all that the Lord has spoken, we will do, that Exodus 19, verse 8. Right? So they make this covenant with God before they hear the Ten Commandments, right?
Correct.
And then they're going to hear the Ten Commandments. And so what is God doing when he's giving them these Ten Commandments?
He's reiterating the covenant just in a different manner.
Okay. Yeah. So he's now going to show his part of what he's going to do in Israel, right? That is
correct.
These are not prohibitions. It does not say, do not have other gods before me. Do not make a graven image. You know, do not take the name of your Lord your God in vain, right? They're not prohibitions. They're God's promising of what he is going to do. So God now is going to make a covenant with them based upon who he is, of what he's offering them. But the people are not impressed. That is, they're going to say all that the Lord, again, they're going to say all that the Lord has said, we will do and be obedient. Right? They don't understand. He's now revealing his character to them, right?
Correct.
Right. Because the Ten Commandments is a transcript of his character. So he's going to reveal his character to them, and they're not going to recognize it. And they're going to break that covenant. Now, Moses understands why they broke that covenant. So when we get to chapter 34 and 33, and Moses is going to receive the Ten Commandments the next time, the second time, there is a change. That is, this covenant is different than the one that was made prior to this, to the giving of the law the second time. That is, we tend not to recognize this. We just kind of call this all the old covenant. But under that covenant that was made, when the people said all that the Lord has said, we will do and be obedient, what, when they made that covenant and they transgressed that covenant, what was supposed to happen? When they made the golden calf, what was supposed to happen that the golden calf, they would die, right? Because when you make a covenant, whatever happens to that, those animals that are slain, that's going to happen to you if you break the covenant. So when God is going to destroy the people, what is God doing? Why is he doing that?
Because they broke the covenant.
They broke the covenant. So they made a covenant, and that covenant required their death. Now, Moses is going to stand in the gap here, typically speaking, and he's going to say, blot my name out of the book of life. So he's standing where Christ is standing. Now, does God really want to destroy the people?
No.
No, he doesn't, right? Because he's a merciful God. But he also has to, stand with this covenant that he's made, that the people have made, because they made this covenant with God. God wasn't asking them to do this. They first made the covenant, God, covenant with God, all that the Lord has said, we will do. You know, we'll keep all these words. He then explains what he was requiring of them, what he's going to do in them if they make a covenant with him. But they said, all that the Lord has said, we will do and be obedient. They can't do it. They don't know their own selves. So they're going to worship a golden calf, and they require death. And so they now renew this covenant. But this new covenant that's being made is different. This covenant's going to have animal sacrifices. It's going to have a sanctuary, a temple. All these things are then enacted under this covenant, not under the one made at Sinai, or prior to Sinai, even prior to the law being spoken in chapter 19. So, I mean, this is just too big of a topic for me to really explain or understand even. But are we not now fulfilling this history of the two new tablets in the proper sense?
Yeah.
We have to see God's glory. So it goes on, and he said, behold, I make a covenant before all people. I will do marvels such as have not been done in all the earth, nor in any nation. And all the people among which thou art shall see the work of the Lord, for it is a terrible thing that I will do with thee. Now, what he's going to do is he's going to make this covenant with Israel, and he's going to demonstrate this in having them enter into the promised land. And they're going to become a type, right? So we know the entering into the promised land is a type for what happens at the end of the world. He said, observe thou that which I command thee this day. Behold, I drive out before thee the Amorite, etc. Take thee to thyself. Take heed to thyself, lest thou make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land whither thou goest, lest it be for a snare in the midst of thee. Have we made a covenant with the inhabitants of the land? Have Seventh-day Adventists done that?
Yes, they have.
Yes, very much.
Has this movement done that?
I hope not.
Well, hopefully not as an entire movement, but I would say that we have. And why would I say that?
Because we have not maintained our faith in God.
Yeah. And because of all the apostasy that we've seen, right? And that still exists. That same danger exists. Because it's going to become a snare in the midst of thee. There is a snare that's in the midst of us that we have to be aware of. Now, our work is to destroy their altars, break their images, and cut down their groves. For thou shalt worship no other god, for the Lord, whose name is Jealous, is a jealous God. Lest thou make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land, and they go whoring after their gods, and do sacrifice unto their gods, and one call thee, and thou eat his sacrifice, and thou take of their daughters unto thy sons. Now, of course, this is talking about literally, but we're not applying this literally. But we can see that this still happens. Now it says, the feast of unleavened bread shalt thou keep, 7 days shalt thou eat unleavened bread. What is unleavened bread?
Well, leaven represents sin.
Yeah.
Well, unleavened is without sin.
Yeah, and bread?
Well, bread's word of God.
Right, the word of God, unleavened. That it's not mixed with sin, with man's interpretation.
Right.
And I commanded thee in the time of the month Abib, that's Nisan as well, for in the month Abib thou camest out from Egypt. And then it's going to talk about the firstborn, right, which is really an important point that we're going to come to. And all that openeth the matrix is mine, and every firstling among thy cattle, whether ox or sheep, that is male. So I'm not going to go into that because we'll come to that. All the firstborn of thy sons shalt thou redeem. So there's a redemption of the firstborn. And this is going to relate to later to the Levites when we get to Numbers chapter 3. And we're going to look at that because this is a really important point. And then he talks about the Sabbath. 6 days shalt thou work, but on the seventh day thou shalt rest. In earing time and in harvest thou shalt rest. And thou shalt observe the feast of weeks. So Pentecost, right? First fruits of the wheat harvest. Feast of ingathering at the year's end. Thrice in the year shall all your men, children, appear before the Lord, the God of Israel. For I will cast out the nations before thee and enlarge thy borders. Now, this is the part that I wanted to get to, and I'm going to, I don't think I have time to actually get through it all. Now, and when it came to pass when Moses came down from the Mount Sinai with the two tables of testimony in Moses' hand, when he came down from the mount, that Moses wist not that the skin of his face shone while he talked with him. So this doesn't happen the first time. This happens the second time. And Paul is going to address this in 2 Corinthians chapter 3. And if you don't understand that this is the second time, you can't understand 2 Corinthians chapter 3. So Paul here talks about commending ourselves. Do we begin again to commend ourselves? Right? So he's talking about people thinking themselves as better than they really are. For as much as ye are manifestly declared to be the epistle or the letter of Christ ministered by us, not written with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tables of stone, but in fleshly tables of the heart. And such trust have we through Christ to Godward. So we trust that God is writing his character up on our heart. Not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything as of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God. You know the reason, I shouldn't say it this way, but I find, this is my observation, that when people are focusing upon they're overcoming sin. And I'm not saying it's wrong to overcome sin. It's not wrong in and of yourself to struggle with the sins in your lives and the little sins. But often what happens is people imagine that they're much better than they are because they've conquered some area in their life that they know of, but are unaware of an other area of their life. And that part that they're unaware of, They're unaware of it because they have not seen God's glory. Because what are they doing when they're comparing them, when they're looking at their sins? They're comparing themselves to others, correct?
Correct.
If I compare myself to others, I might think that I'm better than I am, especially if I choose really terrible people to compare myself to, you know?
Compare ourselves with Christ.
Right. If we compare ourselves with Christ, we will never see ourselves as righteous.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Even if we're reflecting his character fully, we still wouldn't see that we are. We would just see our deficiencies. So he says, not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think anything of ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God. He says, this doesn't have to do with us. This has to do with God's character, not my character, when he writes his law in our hearts. Hmm. Who hath made us able ministers of the new covenant. So are we ministers of the new covenant?
Yes.
And are we able ministers? We're supposed to be able ministers of the new covenant, not of the letter, but of the spirit. For the letter killeth, but the spirit giveth life. Now, some people take that out of context. You know, we don't keep the letter of the law. We keep the spirit of the law. My brother David was like that. He was always focused upon the spirit of the law. And it's not wrong in some ways. But the spirit of the law does not contradict the letter of the law. Yeah. Jeff, you have a really noisy microphone, so try to. I know you like to talk, so when you talk, turn it on and then turn it off, right? Okay, thanks. Just gets on the recording. So anyway, then he says, but if the ministration of death, written on and engraven in stones, was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away. So the ministration of death, he's going to refer to this as the ministration of death. He's talking about the Ten Commandments. And it was glorious, right? So much so that Moses' face shone, even though that glory was going to fade away, right? That glory doesn't last. It's going to fade. So they put a veil over his face until it faded away. How shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? So this question that he's asking, I don't know if we quite can grasp it. Paul sometimes writes things that are a little bit puzzling, because the ministration of the Spirit is the law written and engraven upon the heart. It's going to be glorious. If the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory. Right? So this ministration of righteousness is right doing. That is, you can't have God's glory upon you if you are not obeying God's law. That is, you can't be a sinner, openly sinning, thinking evil thoughts, and have God's character. So we need a manifestation of the character of Christ for us so that we can reflect God's glory. And this happened to Moses, but it was under the ministration of death. And that's because under Moses' law, he that sinned willfully died at the hands of two or three, at the testimony of two or three witnesses, right? So there was no forgiveness for willful sin. And this relates to our study in the book of Hebrews. But we know that we're going to have a final generation that's going to reflect God's glory. That didn't happen with ancient Israel, but they are a type. So if the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious, for if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory. For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect, by reason of the glory that excelleth. So even though the law had glory, the covenant that was made, that was renewed, had glory. It doesn't have glory if you compare it to the new covenant. For that which was done away was glorious. Much more that which remaineth is glorious. Seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech. Now, I don't know if Paul's really using great plainness of speech, but that he says he is. And not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished. Talking about the glory, not about the law being abolished. But their minds were blinded. For until this day remaineth the same veil, untaken away in the reading of the Old Covenant, or the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. So this veil is done away. This is done away. So we can look at the Old Covenant. We can look at what's written here in Exodus and understand it, because it's done away in Christ. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon the heart. And this is true of us. Many Adventists, and I would say us, are included in there. When we read the Bible or the Spirit of Prophecy, are we under the Old Covenant still?
We're supposed to be under the New Covenant.
We're supposed to. But do we understand the Bible? Do we understand the spiritual aspects in God's Word? We're blinded the same way the Jews, because we think we're more righteous than we are. We don't really see God's glory. Mm-hmm. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Who's the it? It's kind of funny, but I mean, they have this word it. What is the it referring to? When it shall turn to the Lord. It's not so clear in Greek.
Sounds like that'll be Moses returning to the Lord. So.
Well, this would be, the it would refer to the children of Israel. Because that's the one that has the veil. And so the only one that can turn to the Lord is the what's being mentioned before, the children of Israel. So the ones that are blinded, their minds were blinded. And I don't know why it says it. It should say they, when they turn to the Lord, but it says it in the King James. The veil shall be taken away. And it's just because it's referring to the children of Israel. Now, the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. So this is a mirror. But when we look into this mirror is the law of liberty. And what is the law of liberty that we're looking into?
Just the Ten Commandments.
Okay, it's the Ten Commandments, but what is it about the Ten Commandments that's different here? The veil has been taken away, correct?
Right.
So, when Moses asked to see God's glory, his hand is hid, but and his face is hid. But is that going to be true at the end with the final generation?
No.
It doesn't seem to be with the 144,000, no.
We have to see God in all of his glory. Now, of course, we see it when he comes the second time. And the ones who have not reflected the character of Christ are going to die by the brightness of his coming. They're going to be destroyed, right? But the ones who have a transformed character, they will go up and meet the Lord in the air. So this is what has to happen. That's what this movement is about. Now, it relates, of course, to the sanctuary, as we'll see, because everything that we're talking about here with the Ten Commandments, they're in the Ark. So they're part of the sanctuary. And the sanctuary is, as we've talked about, is how we come to approach God. So God tells us how we are to approach him. And in order to approach him, because we're sinners, we have to go through a cleansing process. And we also need a mediator, because we couldn't see God. We couldn't approach God without this mediator. Now, first we have priests, but we saw in the book of Hebrews on our Sabbath afternoon studies that Christ is that mediator. And that he's a merciful and a faithful high priest. But that the purpose of his mediation is to restore us once again to God. And we're going to see this, because we're going to be studying that this Sabbath afternoon. We're going to be studying chapter 12, which is going to be addressing some of these same points when we look at chapter 12 of Hebrews. Is it this Sabbath that we do? No, it's not this Sabbath.
Next Sabbath, yeah.
I was thinking that's not right, because I wrote an email saying that I'm not presenting this Sabbath. Okay, so next Sabbath, and then we're going to have chapter 13 on the 25th. Yeah, so I'm getting ahead of myself here. But this covenant that is renewed, notice that it mentions all of these feasts. And the three times in the year. And what are these feasts representing within our lines? Because there's thrice in the year, or three times in the year, shall all your men, children, appear before the Lord God, the God of Israel. What are these feasts that are mentioned?
Passover, Feast of Weeks, and the Day of Atonement.
Right, so the Passover, Feast of Weeks, and it says the Feast of Ingathering at the year's end, but that includes the Day of Atonement as well.
Then I would have been wrong, because that would have been the Feast of Booths. Sukkoth.
Okay, Sukkoth is the one, the Feast of Ingathering? So what's yes. The Feast of Ingathering at the year's end?
Feast of Ingathering would have been Sukkoth, Feast of Booths.
Okay. So that's going to be from the 15th to the 22nd.
Right.
Okay. So, but does that sort of is connected with the Day of Atonement? I mean, I don't know if somebody would go to the Feast of Ingathering, but not go be there for the Day of Atonement.
But the Day of Atonement is national. It's for all of Israel.
Right. So it's for all of Israel.
And the one that you're, the three that you're referring to here, it is the men that are commanded to attend those feasts.
Okay. So anyway, there's the three, and I haven't studied in this enough to know, at least I don't know if I fully understand how we would apply this, but there are three, and I would say that they represent the three angels' messages in some ways. and they represent the whole year, even though they're not starting with the first day of the first month. They're starting with the Feast of Weeks. And the Feast of Weeks starts the 16th day of the first month. Yeah.
I am back.
Okay. Hi, Mark. Yeah. So the shining of the face of Moses, the glory of God that's seen upon him, there's something more that we need to see, both in understanding this, but also personally, and that this movement needs to see. And I don't really know what, I don't really know how that comes about.
Well, if we're looking at this with the understanding that Moses had to be prepared in order to see God, he's given a time period of 6 days, according to Mrs. White.
Yeah. Doesn't she say 7 days?
I believe it's six. I'll look it up and send it to you.
Okay. Yeah, because I think it's on the seventh day, which that would be 6 days cardinally, but 7 days ordinally. It's my understanding of that.
Okay.
But yeah, if you can find the statement, I got to sort that out. Okay. So go on with what you were talking about.
But he has this time of preparation. And the question that I'm asking is not this time, is this not a time of preparation for us in the movement?
Okay. Now, we know that this movement has been a time of preparation. We've had this time of preparation. God has been bringing us through all these times of preparation. But I know that our line ends on December 25th. I'm not looking for some particular event, you know, world event or anything like that. Other than this is the period of time that God has given us from November 9th, the 777 days. And it's obviously symbolic. It represents something, but this movement has to come to some point by December 25th. Or I don't see what would be the purpose of everything that has happened. I don't think we can just keep going on with the same old, that some change is happening in our movement in some way, whatever that is, I don't know. Maybe it's just an understanding that we come to that changes how we work and operate together. Because the one thing I believe is that we have to be united in order to accomplish this task. People pulling in individual directions isn't going to accomplish anything. And we have to be working with Christ. And if we're all working with Christ, we're all working together. You know, I don't believe that we're, you know, supposed to organize and, you know, start some new organizational structure, because that to me is a failure when that happens. That's why I didn't understand why this movement was looking for organization in the way that they were seeking it out, because that is always a failure. We need to be yoked up with Christ. We need to be working with Christ to accomplish what he wants us to do. It's not man's organization that's going to save us. Ellen White's quite clear. It'll be evident that the Lord has taken the work into his own hands. It's not going to be man's machinery. It's not going to be that we have some system in which we're going to be able to spread the gospel. We're organized in a human sense. We're organized in a divine sense at the end of the world. Okay.
This message has to be given to the Levites, right?
And the message that's given to the Levites is something to do with our change of character more than anything else. I mean, I've thought of all kinds of ways to present things in simple ways that people can understand them. But it's not going to be because, you know, we have good explanations of things. Because the best explanations of things aren't going to change other people. There has to be something that happens that's going to, and not the type of thing that we were expecting, you know, like Nashville being hit by a fireball. That's not how God works. It's not going to actually accomplish what we want. What has to happen is something has to change about us. And if that thing changes about us, then we can really affect people in a positive way. But I don't think that this movement as a whole has had that change happen. My prayer has always been that we can have that upper room experience. But I never know how that's possible to happen. I can't make it happen for anyone else, only myself. But somehow, we have to be humbled. Mm-hmm. So, anyway, that's Exodus chapter 34 and 33. I'm not sure, you know, we only got, I guess, three more Fridays that we're going to be before December 25th, because the 24th will be a Friday. You know, to look at these things, and we're not definitely not going to be finished with all of these studies by December 25th. But I do believe that something has to be finished or completed in us as a movement by December 25th. I just don't really know what it looks like. And any final thoughts on these ideas? Anybody have something that strikes them, that God is impressing them, that they need to share?
Yeah, did Moses, did he actually talk to God face to face, or was he just his reflection because the Lord had to turn his back, right? So
yeah, I don't know. I mean, to talk to him face to face, I mean, obviously Moses was speaking to God directly. I think that's what that means.
Yeah, because like the past, well, this week we've been reading in Spirit of Prophecy, Volume 1, Chapter 20, which is the Law of God. So, yeah, and there's a caption here. It says, "And if they could not even look upon the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, because he had been communing with God." Not necessarily face to face, you know.
Yeah, well, that's but the time that the glory happens, that's the second time he receives the Ten Commandments. Doesn't correct. Happen the other times. So there's something about the second time he receives the law, that this repeat of the law, which I believe represents in type this movement at the end of the world, which this movement is a part of the big line. But remember, our movement is the Sunday Law movement.
And right.
This is about the Sunday Law. We're not actually on the big line. We're not to the Sunday Law yet. But our line is not the big line, but it's connected to it. That is, this is a preparation for Adventism to hear a repeat of the first and second angel's messages, so that when the third angel's message is empowered at the Sunday Law, that God's people will be able to stand. To me, the idea is too big. Like, what God is asking, what I see that this movement is about, is too big for us. That is, even to go to the Adventists and give this message, I mean, we're just a few people.
Yeah, the majority of them will probably laugh at us. So.
Yeah, we're not a united people.
The problem, let's not forget, when the apostles and the disciples came together after Christ's ascension, the Spirit was poured out on them, and you had the 11 and the rest that had united with them that gave a message at the Feast of Weeks, which we now call Pentecost.
Mm-hmm.
If we are willing to become united, to set aside our preconceived notions, and to place our reliance wholly completely and totally upon God, then God can work through us and we will see miracles occurring.
Yes, that's what I believe. And so, and that's what I'm saying. We have to have some change. And that's something that has to happen in each of us individually. But God is bringing about that change through a study of his word. Right? You know, we can't just work it up somehow. To see God's glory, God has to reveal that glory to us. And we have to ask him to show us his glory. We have to be willing to see it and everything that it means. And it will affect a change in this movement. That's what I believe has to happen by December 25th. And it's something that we should be committing to prayer every day, especially as we approach 21 days before, because that's a symbol of Daniel's 3 weeks. And that's really where we look at Daniel's 3 weeks and the three touches. And the Spirit of God going into him, right? Getting him to stand up, right? So to me, this is just so big from what we see by sight, what the reality is that we see, but also compared to what God wants to do, those things are a huge leap. But it happened to the disciples. And it can happen to us. Okay. So if anyone else has something to share, if they don't, I can close with prayer.
Just one verse.
James
4:10 says, humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. So that's what we have to do. So
yeah. But this is to see the glory of Christ, whatever that means exactly for us individually. I do know that all the study that we've been doing has shown us things that about ourselves that we would have been unwilling to see in the past. Okay, so let's close with prayer. Dear Father in heaven, we are so very thankful for the Sabbath, for the day of rest and gladness, for the peace that it promises, for the taste of heaven and of fellowship in heaven that we can experience. We ask, Lord, that this Sabbath can truly be a day in which our hearts are broken, that we can see others as better than ourselves, and that we can look upon the needs of others before our own needs. Forgive us for our sins, for our hard-heartedness, for our blindness, especially the blindness to our own sins. We ask for that eye salve, that we can see ourselves as we truly are. We pray for that gold refined in the fire. We are thankful, Lord, for the trials that come our way that make us dependent upon you. And we ask for that white raiment, the garment of Christ's righteousness. We ask that our filthy rags can be removed and that we can be clothed with the change of raiment. We ask, Lord, that we can cooperate with you in this work that you are doing around the world right now, that you're working on many hearts of people that we have no idea of, and that we cannot look at the things that are seen, but the things that are not seen. We trust in those things because they are eternal. So we put our trust in you, Lord, and we pray for one another, and we pray for ourselves that we can represent you. Thank you again, Lord, for leading and guiding in our study. And we ask for your continued presence in the studies that are happening this Sabbath around the world, for people looking into these things that angels desire to look into. And we pray this and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Recordings.